The next lesson that we are going to take a look at is dealing with and keeping with our topic of Texas history is regions of Texas. Again, this is competency three. If you want, and if you also go on to the October 1st section, I have a list of basically subsections of Texas history that could, help you kind of study for Texas history. It's not up there yet, but it'll eventually be up there. And this is as of August 4th, or excuse me, August, October 3rd, 2016. So if you're coming here at a later date, then it should be up there. Now, Texas history, the regions of Texas. We're going to take a look at several different regions of Texas. After this lesson, you should be able to answer the following questions. First, how do people adapt to their environment? Second, how does geography influence the way people live? Again, we're continuing on with these questions. You should be able to answer these after after you watch the first lesson of Natural Texas plus this lesson of the regions of Texas. Now I want you to imagine living in a place that is so hot, dry that few trees can grow there. The land is parched and the air almost shimmers with an intense heat. Mountains rise from a cactus-studded landscape. Wide depressions or dips in the land called basins also cover the area. This part of Texas is known as the Mountain Basins region, located in West Texas and bordered by Mexico and New Mexico. Most of the region lies to the west of the Pecos River. For this reason, the region is sometimes called the Trans-Pecos, meaning across the Pecos River. The Mountain and Basins region of Texas is the highest elevation in the state and is considered to be part of the Rocky Mountain system. For an idea of how high some mountains are in the region, note that 1 mile is about 5,280 feet. Texas has seven mountains standing over 8,000 feet, each well over 1 mile high. All seven peaks are found in this region. The region also includes several ranges and famously high peaks. The Guadalupe Range, which extends into New Mexico, is almost the highest ranges in Texas. Near the center of this region rise the Davis Mountains and Mount Livermore. Also called Baldy Lee Peak, Mount Livermore stands 8,378 feet high. The other highest peak would be the Chisos Mountain, are another significant range. They are located near the southern tip of the region. The Chisos make up the largest range in the area to the south, known as Big Bend Country. The Chahuahan Desert sprawls across much of the region of Texas. Rainfall is not very common in the area. Remember that higher elevated areas tend to have cooler temperatures and get more rain than the lower basin areas. Some parts of this region get from 14 to 18 inches of rain annually, while other parts get less than 14 inches. Summer temperatures average in the mid-90s in desert and basin areas, and slightly cooler in the 80s in the mountains. The hot temperatures and lack of rainfall have affected all life in the region. Although its climate is extreme, this region does lend itself to have a sort of rugged natural beauty to its environment. Flowering cactus plants lend a bright splash of color to the softer colors of the desert. Other desert plants cover the ground. All the plants that grow in the air in this area of Texas are suited to the desert because they require little water. In some cases, they store water in their leaves. This is why, if you ever want to do any type of gardening during the spring, find some of the plants that live in the mountain basins area. Because when summer hits and you can't water that often, the plants that live in this area don't need that much water. So they will survive during the summer months. Now, besides the plants, there are animals that thrive in this region as well, including cougars, mule deer, and black bears. The elk of the region, which had once become extinct, have been reintroduced in the Guadalupe Mountains. Snakes and roadrunners make their home in the desert areas of this region as well. Now, even though this region of Texas is hot and dry, it is nearly bounded on it is nearly bounded on two sides by rivers. The Pecos River runs from the north to the northeast of the region. The curving Rio Grande flows from the western edge of the region and around its southern border. Rivers and other natural features serve as landmarks both to residents and visitors. The most important resource that we have in the state of Texas is not oil or cattle, but water. Because without water, we could not have the growing population that we have here in the state. One of the most important rivers that happens to be within this region of Texas is the Rio Grande. Rio Grande is Spanish for big river. From its source of a mountain stream well above sea level in the Colorado through to New Mexico and into West Texas, the Rio Grande water is used for or has a variety of purposes, mainly to raise cotton. The river allows to raise cotton, but also pecan trees. And it's also good for livestock uses as well. In geography, we usually see that these types of regions, the people will set up their cities and towns along big rivers, because water is available to serve large populations. Not only does it provide water to the people of the mountain basin region, but it also is the southernmost border between Mexico and Texas. Even though with this boundary, Mexico and Texas need this river to depend on basically trade. So businesses in the area depend on this river for trade purposes. Also in this river area or this region of Texas is the Big Bend National Park. The Rio Grande flows along the border of this region. It takes a turn at the southern end of West Texas before heading northeast. The curve is known as Big Bend. Just so you know, Big Bend was our state's first national park. It covers over 1,250 miles, and Big Bend draws many visitors to Texas, mainly for the scenery, the different wildlife that is within this national park, and of course, recreation purposes, as seen here in the picture. Most of the population within the mountain basin region, lies in El Paso. El Paso sits on the Rio Grande at the far western end of the state. A notable feature of the city is its strong business ties with both Mexico and New Mexico. El Paso has strong features of Hispanic culture and traditions. Just across the river is the large Mexican city of Juarez. Together, the population of El Paso and Juarez make it the largest urban center on the United States-Mexico border. The reason that this city is so important to Texas and this particular region of Texas is because of its Because it is the commercial center of the Upper Rio Grande. One factor contributing to trade here in the North American free trade here in the region is the North American Free Trade Agreement, or NAFTA. You'll learn more about this when we get to United States history. NAFTA was designed in 1994 to lessen the barriers to trade between the United States, Canada, and Mexico. Since its conception, NAFTA has grown border trade for all three nations. However, there are those who say that NAFTA has caused more problems in the United States. For example, many factories began moving businesses closer to the Mexican border because of low-cost labor, which resulted in many Americans losing their jobs. So there are some economists who believe that NAFTA was the cause of some of our economic troubles in the late 20th and early 21st century. Some resources that are in the area, even though that it is sparsely populated, it does hold a lot of our state's natural resources, one of which is petroleum and natural gas. This is where it is located. The second region we are going to talk about is called the Great Plains region. It is significant because it is the agricultural region of Texas. Crop growing conditions attracted farmers who helped settle the region. The Great Plains doesn't just end in Texas. It travels through much of the middle portion of the United States. The North American Great Plains has been called the breadbasket of the world. This fertile area stretches from Canada to Texas. It is bounded on the east by the Mississippi River and on the west by the Rocky Mountains. Folk songs written about the Great Plains compare the region to a sea of grass because there you can basically see it almost seems like a vast ocean of pretty much grass. In Texas, the Great Plains region reaches from the upper north corner of the state, known as the Panhandle, to down to the Rio Grande. Before the Europeans ever arrived in Texas, the Great Plains region of Texas looked very different. Great herds of North American bison, or buffalo, once roamed the Great Plains. They fed on the deep-rooted wild grass that covered the region. Native American tribes followed the herds, hunting them for their meat and hides. Eventually, that would not last, as the Europeans, mainly the Spanish, would arrive and take over the land. Once the Europeans took over the land, they used the land to graze at first sheep, but then they would graze cattle. After the Spanish left Texas, and Texas reverted to the control of Americans, the Great Plains would be used by the farmers who came to the region of Texas to practice their trade. They would plow up much of the grassland to plant crops like corn and wheat. However, these enterprising men came to Texas to look for a new source of oil, and this is around the 1920s. When they started looking for oil in what we know as the Texas Panhandle. Because of all this development that took place, specifically the rapid development of the 1930s, the area suffered an extreme drought during the 1930s, and add on to all this development resulted in what we called the Dust Bowl. The lack of rainfall, high winds that caused erosion, and the fact that farmers kept producing so many crops rapidly led to the near collapse of the region. Seeing a need to protect this land, the federal government set up what is called National Grasslands in Texas and throughout the Great Plains region of America. Its purpose was to preserve and protect the depleted land. Today, the land is used largely for grazing livestock, but the overall plan allows for recreational use, wildlife habitats, and soil conservation, and water protection. When you visit the Great Plains region of Texas, you need to know that it is exactly three separate geographic sections that comprise to become the Great Plains: the High Plains, the Edwards Plateau, and the Llano Basin. Visitors onto the High Plains are often awed by the great flat expanse of the land. Imagine how they must have seemed to the region's first settlers, especially those who came from city landscapes or mountain regions. One Spanish explorer, Pedro de Castañeda, described the plains as spacious and level. He further wrote, "The country is like a bowl, so that when a man sits down, the horizon surrounds him all around, and even if a man only lay down on his back, he lost sight of the ground." Running through the panhandle are two rivers, the Northerly Canadian River, and to the south, the Red River. Cattle graze on the Canadian breaks. Oh, excuse me, I've lost my place. Cattle graze on the Canadian River, and a rugged valley created by the Canadian River cuts through it, called the Caprock Escarpment. The Palo Duro Canyon was created long ago when the Red River carried a channel through the Caprock Escarpment. This makes up the different types of landscapes you might see when you visit the Great Plains. In the North and South Plains, the North Plains reach from the Panhandle border to just north of Lubbock. A major commodity in the area, again, is petroleum, cattle ranching, and farming. Amarillo is the largest city. In the Southern Plains, cotton is the primary commodity. The Permian Basin, found in the Southern Plains, is a petroleum-rich area. This is where the city of Odessa is. In the far north, far south of the Great Plains region is the Edwards Plateau. The plateau is a high-level area rising from an escarpment. Its large land area is flat or gently rolling hills. Its southern borders include the South Texas Plain and the Rio Grande. The hilly land nearing the escarpment is the section of the plateau called Hill Country. The plateau's thick soil and is covered is a cover of mesquite, cedar, small oak trees, and shrubbery, making it more suitable for grazing livestock than it is for farming. The plateau's ranchers raise cattle and sheep. The plateau is also famous for producing Angora goats, whose long hair is sheared and sold as mohair, which is used to make sweaters and fabrics. Ranch lands comprise much of the plateau, with a few cities or towns within it. The largest city on the Edwards Plateau is Del Rio, located on the Rio Grande. Like El Paso, Del Rio relies heavily on trade with Mexico and cross-border tourism. Within the plateau lies a section of land called Hill Country. Within Hill Country lay the cities of Fredericksburg and Kerrville. The resort town of Fredericksburg was settled by German immigrants and is famous for its peaches. Visitors come to see a hu and hike a huge pine granite landmark named Enchantment Rock, pictured here. In Kerrville, music fans flock to a large yearly music festival held there. It attracts top performers in folk and other musical styles. Exotic game ranches offer hunting excursions in Kerrville. and areas nearby. Native game is abundant in the hill country. The area is noted for its large population of white-tailed deer. Other hill country attractions include Longhorn Cavern State Park, Barton Springs, and the Pedernales Falls State Park. The Llano Basin is an area of rolling plains and hills across by town main by two, excuse me, two main rivers, the Llano and Colorado Rivers. The work of flowing rivers, river waters, and time has caused significant erosion or loss of soil and minerals. From the basin area, it is the state's smallest geographic region, where elevations lower than the rest of the Edwards Plateau. The construction of dams on the Colorado River created a series of reservoirs known as the Highland Lakes. Lake Buchanan is the largest of the lakes, of the Highland Lakes. These lakes are popular sports, spots for activities such as boating, fishing, and swimming. The Llano Basin economy relies on tourism, hunting, and livestock production. Pecans are an important crop in the basin's northern town of San Saba. The cleaning and processing of wool and mohair happens in the town of Brady, excuse me. Also, the market supply center of Mason caters to nearby ranches and a growing tourism industry. A strong agricultural industry makes the North Central Plains an important contributor to the Texas economy. We also save it for last when talking about the regions of Texas because this is an area that, for the most part, most of us should be familiar with on a day-to-day basis. As we move through the regions of Texas, if we move southeast from the panhandle, we will begin to notice that the landscape will begin to change. The plains change from being flat to rolling and the elevation drops. The hills and valleys of this region are covered with grasses, brush, and weathered trees. Summer temperatures average in the mid-70s. We know that it can get much hotter. During the winter, temperatures average in the 50s. Slightly more rain falls here than on the Great Plains. More precipitation means a variety of crops can be grown in the region. Still, cattle ranching dominates the economy of the North Central Plains. The area tends to be rural with low populations. Populations are highest within the region's few cities, including the largest Fort Worth. Geographic sections of the region are the Rolling Plains, Cross Timbers, and Grand Prairie, not the city, just Grand Prairie. Winter is the dry season in the Rolling Plains. Go back. We'll get to Arlington in a second. Winter is the dry season in the Rolling Plains. If you were to stay in this area, thunderstorms occur year-round and tornadoes occur frequently, but more common during the spring months. We notice this on a regular basis, especially if you've lived here long enough. The rolling landscape includes distinct hills and small plateaus called mesas and flatter flat-top hills called buttes. This area is very suitable for livestock. Again, the area, because of the amount of rainfall, farmers grow cotton, grain, sorghum for cattle feeding, and of course, wheat. Now, the timberland and its economy. So, the Cross Timbers, and of course, Grand Prairie. Types of trees that you will see here is black oak, post oak, hickories, pecans, and elms. This area of the region has provided lumber for firewood and railroad ties, so it's big for the railroad industry. During the time of the Native Americans took refuge in these areas because of the tall trees, so they could hide from their enemies. The woodlands are important to help drain rainfall to preserve as groundwater. And farming does occur in this area, mainly cotton, corn, vegetables, and other drought resistance and other things such as drought resistant Spanish peanuts. The area is known for dairy farming, and you will find the cities such as the tourist town of Arlington and of course Brownwood. It is hard to imagine sometimes what Texas must have been like before all the cities and the metropolises that we have built in our state. However, at one time, Grand Prairie used to be a land of tall grasses, which was used for grazing. Rain quickly drains through the limestone and clay soil. Which was you, it, so it made it difficult for trees to grow anywhere but near streams. Livestock ranching and crop farming are important activities in the Grand Prairie. Crops include cotton, grain, sorghum, wheat, peanuts, and other things. The Grand Prairie city of Fort Worth is the largest in. No, is the largest in the North Central Plains. Fort Worth and Dallas, which lies outside the area of the North Central Plains, are part of a 20-county area called the Metroplex. As a major manufacturing and trade center, the Metroplex. As a major manufacturing and trade center, the Metroplex is an important economic force in the region. Sometimes referred to as the place where the West begins, Fort Worth is an agricultural business center. Area farmers and ranchers are served by the city's grain elevators, feed mills, and related businesses. Other industries important to Fort Worth include aircraft, clothing, and computer manufacturing and finance. Another source of economic activity for the Grand Prairie is Fort Hood, a military installation which is one of the country's largest. Businesses and residents in nearby communities such as Killian benefit from Fort Hood. The last region we will talk about is the Coastal Plains region. The Coastal Plains region of Texas is the state's largest geographic region. Like the Great Plains, it extends beyond the border of Texas. This natural region is part of a long expanse of coastal land. It reaches from eastern and southern portions of the United States into Texas and south to Mexico. Within Texas, the coastal plains lie to the east of the North Central Plains. Its inland border is the Balcones Escarpment. Elevations are low in the coastal region. Height above sea level ranges from just a few feet up to 1,000 feet. So a little geographic information about this region. One, the climate along the coastline is hot and humid, mainly because of the Gulf Coast. The Gulf Coast of Mexico delivers moisture to the coast and creates a more dependable water supply. Three, tropical storms and hurricanes are common in the region. Another geographic feature of this is the resources and population. Because of this area, because of the warmer climate and the good water supply, we will find more people living in this region than any other region in the state. Major trade in the region is, of course, shipping. And of course, resources include pine wood forests and oil. One of the most notable cities within the Coastal Plains region is the city of Dallas. We are the third largest city in Texas. A number of industries such as financial, insurance, electronics, and technology make their home in Dallas. It is also an important commercial and transportation hub. Retailers visit the merchandising center of Dallas. Here they preview items to buy for their stores. Not only do we have numerous markets, Dallas also includes a few cultural landmarks that make Dallas a popular tourist spot. One of which is the Sixth Floor Museum at Daly Plaza, which explores the assassination and legacy of President John F. Kennedy. If you're not from here, or if you ever get a chance, or if you have not gone to Dealey Plaza, or if you ever get a chance to organize a field trip for your students to this museum, I highly recommend it, as it brings to a more tangible reality the history behind JFK and, of course, his assassination. Now, besides cultural landmarks, Dallas is also home to a number of popular sports teams, including the Dallas Cowboys, Dallas Mavericks, and of course, the Dallas Stars. The most important aspect about Dallas is not the commerce, tourism, or culture, but the fact that Dallas has a central location that encourages the movement of people and goods. Transportation routes such as highways, railroads, and the busy Dallas-Fort Worth International Airport provide important links to the nation and the world. This is why some people wonder why Dallas is not the capital of Texas, because we are a busy metropolis. In a way, we are the city that never sleeps for Texas. Other areas of Texas that are important to the Blackland Prairie region is, of course, San Antonio, which is the second largest city in Texas. It has started to become a customer support call center of the country. Three U.S. Air Force bases are located in San Antonio, and there is a large Hispanic population, which makes San Antonio a lively center of Mexican American culture, not to mention some important historical landmarks that are important to the state of Texas. And then there's the city of Austin. It is the state's capital. Several high-tech firms are based in Austin. The University of Texas makes its home in Austin, and of course, the city has a lively music scene. The other region of the coastal region, or another part of the coastal region, is called the Post Oak Belt region. The Post Oak wraps around the northern tip and along the eastern edge of the Black Prairie. This is a timbered area of oak, hickory, and other hardwood trees. This area is also conducive for farming as the soil conditions are good for raising corn, grains, cotton, pecans, hay, watermelon, peaches, and of course, Christmas trees. The land is also used to graze livestock. Farming and cattle are not the only sources of income in this region, as light industry and education also makes their home, excuse me, in this particular area of the region. Texas A&M University is located in the Bryan and Collins State College Station area. Together, the communities are home to about 150,000 people. Medicine, agriculture, and service industries are established here. So, all in all, there is a variety of economic resources in this area. However, even with all of this economic opportunity, the Post Oak Belt has no large cities. The city of Tyler, the region's largest, is nicknamed the Rose Capital of America because of the thousands of roses that are grown there. The most remarkable site in this area of the Post Oak Belt happens to be in and around the area of Bastrop State Park, where a species of Loboli pine or Pinus taeida grow. These pines are sometimes live to be 300 to 400 years old. Experts think that this section of forest was long ago separated from similar trees in the larger Piney Woods geographic area. The forest is known as the Lost Forest, or the Lost Pine, excuse me. The Piney Woods is an area that extends from the Red River to the Texas coast and borders the Post Oak Belt and Gulf Plains. Post Oak Belt and Gulf Coast Plains. The National Forest of Angelina, Sabine, Sam Houston, and Davy Crockett are part of the area. The Big Thicket National Preserve includes dense forest land and swamp. Natural resources include wood and oil. The area is great for growing fruits and vegetables. Major cities include Texarkana, Longview, and Huntsville. All right, moving on. All right, so the Gulf Coast Plains is a it's basically an important region of Texas because this is an area where the cattle thrive because of the excellent grassland. Crops include cotton, grain, sorghum, again for cattle feeding and rice. There is numerous industries in this area, which include oil, natural gas, gasoline, plastics, fertilizer, antifreeze, and synthetic rubber. All of this is, here. We conclude oil and natural gas because this is where we refine it to for oil to create gasoline, so it can get shipped out to basically wherever we need it to get shipped out to. One of the cities in this area, or in this region, is Houston, which is the largest city in Texas. Houston is important to this region because it is economically diverse, with ties to multiple industries, just like Dallas, which include science, technology, banking, and oil. Houston's major economic role is a leader of the state's petrochemical industry. Petrochemical industry being petroleum refining. The port city, of course, and so. So that's basically an important excuse me, let me look at my notes, make sure I'm not forgetting anything. Oil refineries use the city of Houston because of its coastal location to transport oil in tankers, huge ships that carry large amounts of liquid. Not only so basically these tankers and other large ships carry goods through a human-made waterway dug at the city's port or harbor called the Houston Ship Channel. Ships use the channel to travel between Houston and, of course, the Gulf of Mexico. Popular sports teams of Houston include the Houston Astros, Houston Texans, and Houston Rockets. And not to mention, Johnson Space Center for astronaut training is also located in Houston. The last region of Texas. This area of Texas gets much less rainfall than other areas to its north. Vegetation includes prickly pear, cactus, mesquite, black brush, and of course other shrubs. There is a large month growing a 10 there is a 10-month growing season in the area, which makes the industries like cattle ranching and farming possible. And of course, the lower Rio Grande Valley, the rich soil allows for the growing of citrus trees. An important city of this region is El Dorado. Not El Dorado. Laredo, excuse me. Having a hard time speaking today, tonight. All right, so that's, I know that's a lot of information to throw at you. So basically, to sum it up, here is a quick video to kind of sum up everything we just talked about. So I'll come back in a second with a practice test question.
stars at night are big and bright. Deep in the heart of Texas, the prairie sky is wide and high. Deep in the heart of Texas, the coyotes wail along the trail. Deep in the heart of Texas, the rabbits rush around the brush. Deep in the heart of Texas.
So let's go look at a practice question real quick. Alright, nope, not that one. Not that one. Not that one. Ah, practice question. So practice question. Here is the practice question. Alright, where are the vast plains of Texas located? A, in the northern and western parts of the state. B, in the southern and eastern parts of the state, C, in the central and eastern parts of the state, or D, in the central and western parts of the state. Now, basically, when I would look at this question, the first thing I would notice is, of course, plains of Texas. All right, and so that would be the first, that is what the question is asking for. Okay, plains of Texas location. All right, then I would look at, okay, all of these have states. Okay, let's look at this. Northwest, southeast, central east, central west. And I would picture a map of Texas in my head, or the best I could in my head. And I would like, okay, where is the Great Plains region? And so after I figured it out, I would basically look back. So northwest, no. Southeast, no. Central east, no. It would be D. All right, D. Central western. Alright, so basically look at the portion of this question. In this case, in this case, plains of Texas. Plains of Texas, and then basically just look at key parts of these questions. All right, and so you should be able to, because you know it shouldn't be the northern and western part, because that's the Panhandle, Mountain Basin, southern and eastern part. No, that's like hill country. Central and eastern part, getting closer, but it's more central and west, midwestern part of the state. So I hope this lesson was good for helped you. These were, of course, the last two. Natural Texas and this one were both competency three for studying. The last video that, or the last lesson that we covered on the September 24th, 2016 review session was, of course, the early peoples of Texas. And part of that lesson was, of course, a gallery walk. Until next time, we will actually talk about history with competency two, Texas history, the early peoples of Texas.